Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Hi. Yes, thank you very much. I also like a little bit of audience participation. It makes the night go so much easier. I am one of the co-authors. My other co-author, who I'm going to dump right in it because he hasn't got here to start, feel free to save all the really difficult questions for the part where he gets here. And I'll say that you'll be doing that all the way through, I promise. So, my name's Caroline Carruthers. I'm currently the Chief Data Officer for a company called Lowell, which is a finance company, and previous to that, I was Network Rail's Chief Data Officer. In both circumstances, I was the first Chief Data Officer, so there must be something wrong with me to do it again.
Were you the first female one as well?
Well, in both companies, I was the first female Chief Data Officer completely. I don't think I was the first Chief Data Officer female ever, but probably close. Peter is currently the Chief Data Officer for Southern Water. Previous to that, he was the Chief Data Officer for the Pensions Department, so he's as mad as I am. We wrote the book basically because there is a lot of confusion about what Chief Data Officers do, how they interact, what they bring to the party, and what you need to think about if you want to get a Chief Data Officer. So I'm going to talk about some of those topics as we go through the book. But if you have any questions, any burning issues, anything that you go, good God, she's talking a load of twaddle, pitch in. It's always much better when we have a little bit of interaction as we go through. And trust me, you will get sick if you hear my dulcet tones for a full hour slot. Okay? So, make sure I can move on. Great. So all I'm going to do is talk a little bit about each chapter in the book. Some of them will be more relevant to you, so feel free to stop and ask more questions on those particular ones. If you're really bored by them, I will move on as fast as I can. But obviously, hopefully, you'll find something interesting for you as we go through the book. Number one, why does any organisation need a Chief Data Officer? Because they've got along perfectly fine without them. Well, the honest answer is, they kind of did. You know, I can't sit here and go, nothing worked, the world ended, it was like Chicken Little running around all the time because there wasn't a Chief Data Officer. That fundamentally is not true. Organisations have existed for a long, long time without Chief Data Officers. The difference is they have not capitalised on their data as an asset. And we'll talk a little bit about where that responsibility lies through the organisation in a few chapters on. But having somebody whose sole focus is the data and information of your organisation means that is what they think about. As an IT professional, you tend to think about security, infrastructure, customer service. They tend to be the main things that focus on your mind. If you're a chief financial officer, money is a bit of a giveaway. And the balance sheet, up until now, until I was dealing with the Chief Data Officer, nobody really cared in the same way about the data within an organisation. And that makes a fundamental difference. Now, I'm not talking about some of the data startups that's starting, like the Ubers and the Airbnbs and all those kind of really interesting companies. But we are having more and more examples of where a Chief Data Officer can make a big difference. An example is Network Rail. My team cost Network Rail in the first year 1 million. I saved 5. Didn't do anything. I didn't think rocket science because I was still in the building phase. I was still doing the strategies. I was still putting a lot of the foundational stuff in place. But that was the low-hanging fruit from someone thinking end-to-end about data within an organisation. With me so far? Excellent. Secret ingredients of a Chief Data Officer. Now this is where you test my memory, because there's seven secret ingredients, and guaranteed I'm probably going to forget one and have to look it up. So I'll try my very best. Number one, and I think the most important skill for a Chief Data Officer, is the ability to communicate. We at heart have to be storytellers. It is not an easy role, because you are basically piddling and everybody else is gone. So you need to be able to convey that story, to bring people on the journey with you, to work with them and engage them, excite them. The communication skills for a Chief Data Officer have to be absolutely top notch. especially when you're first generation chief data officer like I am, because more often than not, you walk in and they go, ah, that's it, we've got chief data officer, problem solved, we'll all walk in now. Or my other favourite, oh, we don't have to worry about GDPR, we've got you. Does not work like that. Okay. So you need to be able to realistically set expectations, convey with people at all levels of the organisation, but really bring that storytelling to life. Number two, and it kind of ties in with with the communication, but it's about relationship building. As I kind of mentioned, a lot of rest of the organisation, apart from IT, sits in silos. So they're worried about a particular part of an organisation. Data does not sit in a silo, it doesn't exist in a silo. It moves right the way through the organisation and back again. Because of that, you need to be able to work with all the different areas within a business. When I first started doing some of these talks, and I hadn't realised I got this nickname, but I was called the coffee and cake lady. It's not an interesting nickname. So I had to go and ask somebody what it meant. And it was because one of the things that I emphasise quite heavily is when you start in one of the chief data officer roles, is to get out there, make people feel comfortable, buy them coffee, buy them cake, and in a comfortable environment, talk to them and start and build those relationships. You're new to the table. You know, this isn't something that they've maybe used to before. They maybe, in some cases, have really brilliant data analytics and data science stuff going on without any of the foundational stuff that I'm trying to backpedal them to. So you need to take time to build those relationships, because it's much, much easier when you go to someone and go, you're going to hate me, but you've got to stop doing that, if you have some kind of established relationship with them in the first place. Does that make sense? Is that something you can all resonate with in your organisations? Come on! Right. For anybody who was under any illusions, this is my errant core author. Right. So that's quite ironic that Chief Data Officer didn't get the data right. Lucky, just talk about it, it's great. So, number two, relationship building. Number three, you have to have a passion for the data. I mean, seriously. If you don't, you're kind of barking up the wrong tree. I was at a conference once where somebody turned around and won a big, big session and went, well, you know, data's boring. You are in the wrong job. You are absolutely, totally, fundamentally in the wrong job. I think what I do is incredibly exciting. I think a lot of the things that are happening across the world in data is fascinating. All the stuff that it's been built into, it feeds blockchain, it feeds Internet of Things, it feeds AI. If we don't get the data right, none of that will be right. How can that not be exciting? So that, I call myself a data cheerleader. It's a phrase I use quite a lot, and I'm hoping to convert all of you to data cheerleaders by the time I finish tonight. So, number four, I hope somebody else is keeping count for me, by the way. So, number four, you need to have the ability to think strategically. You have to be able to be big picture. Bear in mind that to do a really good data strategy, you have to feed into the business strategy. You need to be able to work at that level. And especially it also ties into what I was saying about data not sitting in silos. You need to be able to see the full picture, and also how you can butterfly effect it, manipulate something over here and make something over here a lot better. Number five is the credibility aspect. So as well as speaking to the board, I need to be able to speak to everybody else in the organisation. Doesn't matter what level, doesn't matter what discipline, I need to be able to talk to them around how they use their data. Now, funny fact, whenever I have those conversations, I tend not to use the word data or information. I talk to them about what keeps them awake at night, what issues they're finding, what do they want to do. Those are the kind of conversations that will help you gain credibility, and that's the kind of skill that you need as a chief data officer. Where am I up to? Do you remember?
Six.
Number six. Thank you very much. Okay, so number six is... and I'm just trying to buy myself time. 2 seconds. Do you remember what number 6 is?
I don't know what your first 3 were.
Oh!
I know what number 7 is.
No, well, I know what number 7 is. Yes. That's the easy one. Yeah.
Have you covered relationship building?
Yes. Comms.
Comms?
Yes. Told you this would happen.
Strategic?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Strategic blending with the tactical?
Passion, yeah.
Passion.
Julian's desperately looking at the list for me.
I
think whilst Caroline's about that, there are a couple of points there that I can pick up. One is about that passion, realising how to translate that passion into the context you're in. I think I have a unique opportunity, being at Southern Water as their first chief data officer, to get very passionate about the change that data could bring to a water utility company. It's never really addressed its data properly, never understood the power of its data to asset management over a 20-year or 30-year period, over its customer relationships, over the quality of its water, over its operations. And data is going to be transformational in that context. And I think that it's very easy for me to get passionate about it. I'd like to say that's why I was late here today, because I've been passionate about it down in Worthing, but I wasn't. And I think also that ability to blend the strategic with the tactical. And certainly in the last 2 instances where I've been chief data officer, currently on the one previously, is seeing the immediate problems that data could fix, or the problems that we could fix immediately, fairly simply, fairly tactical solutions. At the same time, building those into a strategic plan, so there's no regret spend, no regret time waste, no blind alleys that are being run down. And then being able to translate that narrative, as Caroline was saying, from top to bottom across the business, about being able to translate what the future would look like in a data-enabled world, and being on message the whole time, both the board and the people who are actually handling the data at the bottom.
I remember what number 6 is now.
There you go.
So it's about being a specialist, but it isn't about understanding everything to the nth degree. It's a chief data officer, though. If I don't understand what a data warehouse is and the difference between it and a data lake, somebody's going to think I'm an idiot. So you at least have to talk the language. You have to have a high degree of data literacy to be able to communicate properly with the other people who do actually know what they're talking about as well. And number 7, which is my personal favourite, is everybody needs a little bit of luck. And I mean that quite seriously. I have seen really good organisations suffer horrendous losses because they were just hit at the wrong time. Some of the viruses that we've seen, the one that hit the NHS really, really badly, to be honest, I know a lot of organisations there for the grace of God went off. You know, it was luck that got you through. It wasn't good planning or all the rest of it. I'm sure there was lots of organisations that were ready, but I also know lots of them that just happened to miss the train, thank God. So everybody needs a little bit of luck.
I think it's also the luck of the context, again, you find yourself in, arriving into a situation. Do you have those skills in the existing team that you already need, or elsewhere in your organisation? Do you have people who are SQL specialists? Do you have people who can write R and Python? Is your IT estate in a fit state that it could support advanced analytics? Is there a competent data warehouse there already? Or are you going to have to start building from the ground up, and therefore that will add time to your strategic delivery?
Did everybody notice not part of that list is about being technical? Not one part. There are technical people already in the organisation. You work with them. You do not need to replicate what they do. I'm going to leave that one.
First 100 days. This was actually your original pitch, wasn't it?
It was.
First 100 days. Caroline and I have, between us, had the first 100 days quite a lot in the last 2 years. And it's really important, I think, upon arrival, to actually have a plan for the first 100 days, rather like a new president, and be able to look back and say, this is what we've achieved, this is what I set out in the first 100 days. And I think one of the most important things in the first 100 days, certainly if you're going into an industry you're not a specialist in, is to do an awful lot of listening. Do an awful lot of listening to the pain the organisation, and I mean the business probably, the business is feeling pain around how it's handling data, or badly handling data, or its relationship with IT, they can't get IT to do this, they can't get these reports out easily, SAP, or you know, whatever it is, it keeps on falling over. Understanding what the pains are. So the first 100 days, I do a huge amount of listening. Caroline calls it cake and coffee. She sits down buys her cups of coffee and listens to them. I just tend to look very patiently and try and ask intelligent questions. Because I don't like coffee and cake particularly. But I think one of the first things that I've introduced in both of my last engagements in the first 100 days, and it's partly driven by what was going on in the wider ecosystem, GDPR. And so getting data governance embedded in the first 100 days, or even starting to shift that culture towards data governance, is really, really important in the first 100 days. One of the most important things I've tried to embed in both places was the concept of data ownership. Something that I have found when I've arrived places is almost a complete abdication of ownership of data, right the way around the business. The business doesn't want to own it because they think it's owned in the tins and the boxes run by IT. IT don't want to own it because it's the business data. And so it's just not owned by anybody. So in the first 100 days, establishing some form of data governance framework or information governance framework, if there isn't one already. If there is an information governance framework, explaining the subtlety difference around data governance to information governance is quite a good thing to establish in the first 100 days. And then, I have to be very careful, none of my team here, so I can say this, quick wins. Looking for quick wins. Looking for things where you can relieve pain very quickly, very fast. What else would you look at in the first 100 days? What have you looked at?
So I tend to look at three work streams more than anything. So for me, once you've got the context part out of the way, it's around understanding your information architecture. So how does information flow through your organisation? Where does it come from? Where does it go? What happens to it on that journey? And very importantly, who's accountable for it? And a lot of the time, the first 100 days you get, it's not me. And trying to start and piece that journey together is a really important part of your first 100 days. Second one is around the governance, as Peter said. So it is around making sure that you understand what policies are out there. Are they simplistic? Are they consistent? Do they make sense? You have no idea how many organisations I've spoken to who literally must be setting their staff up to fail. Because I'm a data specialist and looking at their policies, I would have no idea what they wanted me to do with that data. If a policy is longer than 2 or 3 pages, it's not a policy. It's not worth the paper it's written on. It has to be simple and consistent. And it's looking at how you communicate all that with your staff. Third one is all around the hearts and minds, because that journey starts day one. So some of it's to do with coffee and cake, but some of it's to actually understand the ebb and the flow and the heartbeat of an organisation and how you can start to make subtle changes to it and bring people on that journey.
I think also because you could be embarking on quite a formidable transformation that's powered by changes in data and the way data is used. Seeking your sponsors and your friends, finding the people on the executive leadership team or the board who are going to back you, who get the vision, finding your allies in the business whose business processes you're going to enhance, who you're going to make look good because they're going to have better data, be able to make better decisions. So finding your allies and your friends is really important.
Delivering a data strategy in the cauldron of BAU. I often use the analogy, when you come into an organisation, that putting a data strategy in is a bit like trying to perform open heart surgery on a marathon runner. You can't stop the organisation and go, well, everybody, just down tools, give me about 3 months to figure this out, and then you can all start again. I'm pretty sure I know what the answer would be if I actually said that to any organisation I worked with. So to take the analogy a step further, it's not about performing open heart surgery because you don't have that opportunity. It's about making sure they've got the best shoes, give them extra water, give them what they need to help them finish the race in a better state. There's a lot about getting an immediate data strategy. So it's to get those quick wins. It's to get the things that will make your difference to buy you the time to make some of the more fundamental strategic changes that you do. So we tend to talk about two strategies. One is the immediate and one is the longer term. And basically the simple thing is it's the quick wins, it's the now, but it's about making sure that you don't waste your time and your effort doing something that will be completely thrown away by the time you get to your longer term. It's about that building block side of things.
Mm. It's about articulating that to the business as well, letting all parts of the business, including those in the board and executive leadership team understand that there are two things going on simultaneously. There is a tactical and immediate data strategy, and it will change or morph, the emphasis will change as you move into a strategic approach. That strategic approach may be linked to bigger IT spend or bigger OT spend, and so they have to blend together with other things at the same time. And so it's part of the orchestration of that vision across the business that is really important.
Rule number one, though, when it comes to data strategy, it has to tie into business strategy. If there's no business strategy, there will be no data strategy.
So how do you see a data strategy tying in with a digital strategy? Because as you mentioned earlier, there's a lot of really cool stuff happening in the data space. So you've got artificial intelligence, internet things, all of the devices. I know that for sure my CTO is getting super excited, jumping up and down and running off with the network strategy director to look at the OT and the IoT stuff. And they're heading off in a direction, and then we've got the data strategy as well, and there's so much of an overlap between the digital strategy and the data strategy. How do you work?
Just say data feeds digital.
I start from seeing digital really is around platforms and technology, and data is around data that's in them. A Fitbit doesn't make anybody fitter in itself. It's the data in it and the insight from that data which changes people's behaviours. And I try and use that analogy in the business. Somebody asked me the other day to speak about the impact of IoT on the water industry. And I said, we've had IoT for over 20 years. It's called telemetry. No, we've got sensors everywhere. The difference is, and that's digital, let's call that digital, there's some that's a bit analog at times, let's call that digital. The difference now is tying a data strategy. The fact that we can now receive and store that data and can even contemplate processing it. Whereas 20 years ago, no hope. So you then start thinking about a data strategy linking with perhaps a digital strategy of the things in the field. What is it? What is it we want to see in that data? Is it changes in pressure? Is it peaks in pressure? What is it we want to see? That's nothing to do with digital really, that's to do with the data. Does that help?
Yeah, sure.
Yes. This kind of relates to, this is the Gartner concept, which we've all seen many times before. And this is the thing that actually keeps me awake at night, not worrying about water quality or flooding or burst pipes. I'm always constantly trying to work out, right, I'm about 11 months in, where am I on this? Have I managed to leap across to here, or am I about to slide down into a deep cavern of despondency? Something I've worked out in the last year, since we wrote the book, Caroline, you haven't heard me talk about this, I think that one's relationship with different people and businesses at different points on this curve. Mm. So I think I'm still here with my board and my C-suite peers. I think they still think everything's great, it's going nicely, we get the strategy, we get the vision, there's nice quick wins going on over here. I think that perhaps I'm almost down here with my team. I think they're saying, you told us we're going to go faster than this. You told us we wouldn't have a problem with procurement. You told us we wouldn't have a problem with IT. You told us we could just fire up Azure or AWS. And we haven't. And so I think that they're down here. They came in all singing, all dancing, but has that much changed? We've deployed a few tools, not done much automation yet. It's frustrating. What I'd love to do would be to sort of glide from there to there with everybody. Impossible dream. So avoiding the hype cycle, since writing this chapter with Caroline last year, I think it's impossible to avoid. I think the really cool thing about it, and the thing to get my head around, is how you manage that hype cycle. So what do I do to engage my team whilst they're feeling a bit despondent down here? What can I do to make them feel good about themselves, to make them get back up onto a level playing? And that's actually what I'm grappling with at the moment.
Do it next time, right, book.
So I think that being aware that this exists is really important. I think we all know, we all smiled in recognition when you see it, is how you handle it and how you plan things. And I have learned, a bit of a wily old dog every now and then, let's not promise everything straight away. Let's save a few goodies just to dump in the trench when you need it.
So, relating to the rest of the business, I think this is possibly one of my favourite cartoons from the whole book. So you've got a lovely table here with the CISO, the CTO, CIO, and you've got a little picnic table with cheap Datrons. Because that's how it tends to feel when you first walk in to do one of these roles. It's a kind of add-on. Everybody's looking at you, they're not really sure how it fits as part of the whole. The question I get asked quite a lot is about how the difference between a CEO and a CIO. which I thought might be quite relevant tonight. And I always talk about the water in the bucket analogy. I know Peter can take it a step further because he works with water, so he always has to. But the whole idea is that the CIO is concerned with the bucket, and it's got to be the right size and in the right place, and it has to be secure, and it has to not have holes in it. The CDO is concerned with fluid in the bucket. Is it the right fluid? Is it the right amount? You know, we have to talk to the CIO about that kind of volume. So that's the kind of analogy that, for me, makes it work. But that's only one relationship within the C-suite that the CDO has to contend with. So obviously, chief financial officers as well. Anybody who holds budget is a very important person. So they're always somebody you need to spend time with. This is where the whole relationship building aspect comes in, but the chapter talks a little bit more about the different relationships that you'll probably have with those, with those different roles that are already established, and some little techniques to maybe help you get through some of that.
Yeah, this chapter we also look at who the CDO reports to, and I think when we get together with our peers, and you sort of do that sort of immediate sort of poll, won't they? How many people report to CFO? How many people report to CAO? How many directly to CEO? How many hold that executive position directly themselves and report into, to the chairman or directly onto the board? It's all over the place, absolutely all over the place. There is no commonality. It tends to be the person you do report into, or the CEO reports into, tends to be the person who had the bright idea to recruit the CEO.
Yep.
And when I first got my contract at Southern Water, I was reporting to the CFO. And when I arrived, I was reporting to the Director of Strategy, because he was new, and he'd come in, so he said, oh, data strategy, that kind of ties in, makes sense. And within 2 days, well, we had the conversation of, I don't understand what you do, I understand it's quite interesting, but I have no idea what you do. That was the conversation that was coming my direction. I thought, this isn't going to work. So I went and found the COO, essentially, and he said, yes, we're going to transform this business and data is important, so you come with me. The most important thing, the common denominator for a successful CDO, I'm absolutely convinced, Gartner says that 50% of us are going to fail in the next 2 years. I think there's two reasons for that. One is an organization's recruited the wrong CDO. They don't know actually what they want. They want a data scientist, they want a data governance, they want, which we'll talk about in a minute, they've recruited the wrong person for the wrong job. And secondly, that person hasn't been empowered. So they're doomed for failure from the moment, because some of the things we talk about are absolutely horizontal across the business. And unless you're empowered to do that, you will not get successful traction. So the moment, going back to the hype cycle, the moment I feel a bit wobbly on that and I wake up at night, I just check my head, am I still being backed up in this? Am I still being supported? Sometimes I go and test it, just prod the beast to make sure it's still with me. The reason we put this chapter in is because I think the term disruptor is often misunderstood. A disruption to me is something that changes the business model. So if I was asked if I was going to be a chief data officer coming into Southern Water, was I going to disrupt the business? Yeah, it might sort of cause a few waves, but was it going to change fundamentally the business model? We carry on supplying water and taking wastewater away. That would be fundamentally our business. I try to cast my role, and many chief data officers' role, as an innovator. In other words, what we're trying to do is do the same business process, but accelerate along it faster, do it better, do it more efficiently, do it quicker, do it cleaner, do it with higher standards and higher values, rather than changing, fundamentally changing the business model. So I think that I try to recast, setting those expectations, coming back to the hype cycle, it's all about setting expectations. People think I'm going to be a disruptor, particularly as a first-generation CEO. Probably wrong. What I'm looking for is innovation, is to move things forward faster.
Yeah, there is potential with a second-generation CDO, which we will explain in a second, the different terms, to be more of a disruptor. But first-generation is definitely more innovation. Okay, building the team. I cannot do this on my own. Peter, as great as he is, cannot do this on his own. There are other roles that you will need around you to be able to succeed. Now, the chapter doesn't talk about the stuff that we already know exists, so you might need project managers, but I didn't feel the need to explain those. you know, you might need a business analyst. Again, we didn't think that we needed to be explicit about those type of things in the book. They already exist. The kind of things that we did think we put in the chapter was different aspects that maybe don't exist as commonly in organisations that you will need to bring in as part of the people that sit around you. So things like an information architect or a data architect, depending on how you term it, the person who will help you understand that information flow through the organisation and the accountability. The type of having an idea about stewards who will govern the governance of an organisation, who will help you write the policies, who will work on the assurance side of the data with you. Having those kind of roles, we tend to put them in pillars, and I know that I build my teams around those type of pillars. And I'll do something similar as well. You bring in your analytics, you bring in this data scientist, you have the different ideas, but there should only be maybe 4 or 5 direct reports. The teams themselves potentially can be very small, depending on the model that you use when you build your team. So you can either have a very competency-based centre type of model, where you have maybe 10, depending on the size of your organisation, in the team, and then use the multi-hub and spoke model, because the end goal you should be aiming for is that everybody in your organisation is a data advocate, that everybody understands that your data is an asset and it's valuable and treat it accordingly. But you won't get that on day one. So I tend to think of it as you have this nice little guiding light, and you go out and you find all your champions in the business, and you pass the light on to them and you listen to them, and they continue to pass the light on, and it looks like lots of little spiders webs starting around your organisation, which is one model. I know that you use another model, which is to bring it more centrally.
My two real examples I can share with you, the pensions regulator, when I arrived there, being quite a young organisation, they were quite data mature, but parts of the business who were handling data very well. And so there was no need to disrupt them and bring them into a centralised function. So we established a core central office of the CDO, and then we used a matrix structure. So they remained in their lines of business, their line management, and their specialisms, but the standards and approaches and the tooling and the expertise came from the centre. My current role, because I arrived and data was so siloed and so spread across the organisation, and huge amounts of money were being spent inefficiently on how data was being used and prepared and reported on, the only approach to me was, I thought, was to bring them centrally, to bring the data centrally, to bring the people centrally, and to organise them centrally, and bring them away from those silos to get that commonality around data sets, data governance, data management, data tooling, standardisations of reporting. It made a very good business case, but it also is certainly something that's evolving. I can see in 2 or 3 years' time, you might push some of those functions like data science back out into the business to sit into the business and allow increasing amounts of self-service from governed data sets once we've managed to establish that. So the structure I built a senior team. I have a head of data exploitation, which is where my data architects, data engineers, my BI, MI sit, and where my advanced analytics and data science sit, all around data exploitation. The data delivery team, head of data delivery, who has a team of basically business analysts. They look at how the business processes are using data and redesign them so they're more efficient. They design the automation and then hand off their plans into the data exploitation team. The head of data governance, which is all around data quality, data standards, data lineage, data maturity. And then I have a, bizarrely, because of the context of data services team, is actually supplying large amounts of data into the business, but again, in governed packages and for regulatory reporting. I have a fifth tier, which is around data team transformation, because we've actually been doing such a big piece of work of bringing these teams together. Have an interim head of data team transformation. So he's actually delivering sort of the tactical pieces here, whilst I'm sort of being able to look more strategically into what we call the next AMP phase, next 5-year planning cycle.
One of the terms that Peter used there that's incredibly important when it comes to data is the matrix team. And I know that lots of organisations use the term a matrix team in lots of different ways. For us, it's a really important one because there are areas that you will have to work with. And as far as the business should be concerned, you are one team. So the CISO, for instance, Chief Information Security Officer, If you are not back-to-back with your Chief Information Security Officer as a CTO, you're going to have a problem because you will confuse the business. So I spend an awful lot of time with other elements like that within my business. They don't need to work for me. We don't have to sit next to each other and hold hands all the time. What we do need to do is put a united front on. It's a bit like being part of a family. You can say what you like to each other, but you say united front if anybody else tries to listen. It makes it much simpler for the organisation, and at the end of the day, they are your customers. They are the ones that you have to make this simple and consistent for. The next 300 days. So you don't get to the end of your first 100 and go, yee-haw, I've done it, I'm going to put my feet up and relax. Guess what happens on after day 100? Day 101. It doesn't actually stop. So you've had that first, you go through the trough, you're starting to, in the first 100, it's probably a fantastic time and it's lots going on and you're full of energy. And then you have to maintain that level of energy, because it doesn't get any easier, especially as a first generation chief data officer. And to be honest, even as a second generation chief data officer, it doesn't actually get any easier, because the volume of data and what organizations want to do with data just keeps getting faster and just keeps getting harder. So you've given them some quick wins. You've established that this wonderful amorphous thing that they didn't really think about too much and called data can now do some really incredible stuff. So what else can you do? What more can you do? How can you push that envelope? So there's no real secret to the 300 days other than it's the strategies for keeping that momentum, it's for keeping it going, it's making it sure that you still get to day 301.
Yeah. Certainly at the end of the first 100 days is a time where I sort of stand back and say, get my head out of the weeds, because you've been very much, or I find I've been very much in that immediate day strategy, wanting to keep the story going, keep the delivery going. And it's time to stand back and just say, yeah, where do I want to be in 5 years' time? Have I lost that? Have I forgotten it? Am I still on that journey? Am I still articulating that journey well?
Yeah, that's what you use the 300 days for.
So, we identified what we think were three generations of CDOs. Last week, actually, Tim Carmichael, who was the Chief Data Officer of the British Army, we started talking about the fourth generation of CDOs. So we're evolving constantly. But Caroline and I first identified the first generation of CDOs as people who are the very first people who have that sole and explicit responsibility for data and data strategy within an organisation. They are the first person who's had that label put on their back. And they are the people who are going to deal with that immediate legacy of how the business has handled its data in the past. All of those sort of siloed approaches, all of those Excel spreadsheets, all of those Access databases, all of those data warehouses that failed in the past, all of those sorts of things, taking those on board at the same time as trying to develop a data strategy. At the same time as realising that your name has been put on the risk register as a mitigating factor for a risk and coping with that kind of thing.
Just your name, that's it, that's all the problem.
So the second generation is clearly the one who follows on behind the first generation, somebody who's actually going to add real value to the basic building blocks the first generation has put in. So the first generation is there to put in the data governance, the data management, the proper building blocks to build off, to add value in the second generation. Somebody pointed out to me a couple of weeks ago that it doesn't need necessarily be two different people. The first generation chief data officer could morph into at some point being that second generation chief data officer, and the basic building blocks are there, you can then start adding real value. And then the third generation is probably that CDO who's moving into an executive position. He's actually in a real business decision-making role based on their contact with the data and providing insights to the business.
A really simple way of managing the difference between a first generation and a second generation, because I do know some people who have followed on from a first generation chief data officer who I would still class as a first generation chief data officer, because they're looking at the risk averse side of the pendulum. So if you look at the scale, it's the risk averse to the value add. And realistically, as a chief data officer, you're going to be somewhere on that scale and looking at both ends at some point in time. But if your main focus is on the risk averse side of things, you're a first generation. If your main focus is on the second side, about the value add, you're a second generation. it's the third generation that starts to build on all of it. Okay, so what type of chief data officer are you or we? Peter alluded to it. A lot of the reasons we think why chief data officers will fail is because an organization needed one particular type of chief data officer, and that's not what they got. Because unfortunately, we are a very different beast when it comes to all these kind of things. So we've identified four different areas that chief data officers tend to come from. And one of the wonderful things that I find about this is that I'm constantly learning, because everybody who becomes a chief data officer adds something else to this. We don't have a traditional background. People come from marketing, technology, so many different diverse areas, and each one of them are adding something more and making this a richer role. But there's four different areas, and this is where you get to test my memory again about Peter's here, and he always remembers them. But one area is technical. People do come from technical backgrounds into a chief data officer. That was my area. So I was originally technical-ish. I'll have to put the ish on there, because I'm sure if anybody tested my technical knowledge, they'd find me wanting. So technical-ish. So that was one of the things that I came into. The other side is the big analytics, data science potentially. That's another route that people are coming into the chief data officer role for, because they're recognising that they're spending so much time trying to do the really brilliant value-add stuff, but they're doing it with crap, basically. So what can they do to actually get that end-to-end better? You can do that.
So we've had the technical,
yep.
Data science,
yep.
Governance. I think sort of a birthplace, a route into chief data officer roles is from people from governance. I think GDPR has fueled that particularly in the last 18 months. And fourth, from strategy. I think people coming in from strategic backgrounds have been going into the role of chief data officer, because to develop a data strategy. I was introduced to a fifth one the other week. Somebody said they're seeing chief data officers coming from operations. There's people coming from the operations, that might be marketing, or in our case, it might be coming from purely an operations and engineering point of view, coming into that role of chief data officer. I think any organisation who gets all of them, gets a blend of all of those four or five things together, is going to end up with the unicorn chief data officer, the one who's multi-skilled the right way across the board, can talk in many of these different languages and currencies with fluency and ability. Don't know how many of those are around.
This is the point, is that you will need these kind of different skills. That's where your team comes into play.
Something that's very interesting is the concept of strength-based leadership. It's really important to understand what type of chief data officer you are, and when you're building that team, make sure that if you're not a data scientist, you might be able to lead data scientists in a strategic way. If you're not a data scientist, you need somebody quite senior who really does understand data science, the application of data science, and what resources and technology you need. If you're not good at governance, make sure you've got somebody really good at data governance around you, and so on. If you're not a tech specialist, make sure you've got somebody who understands the data technology.
Yep. Know yourself. Yep. Very important in any aspect. This kind of ties on from the previous chapter, really, and how you present yourself. This is it's quite a simple chapter, but it's to give new chief data officers some hints and tips about some of the things that they need to do to present themselves as a chief data officer. It helps with data literacy. It ties back into some of the earlier chapters as well, but it's a really good reminder on what kind of things you need to focus on to be a credible chief data officer. There's anything more in that chapter. I'm conscious that it's 20 past, am I really right? Tinker Tailor Soldier Data basically is a nice little Easter egg in the middle of the book. It was a story written by Tim Carmichael, who at the time was the chief data officer for the British Army. And it just gives a lovely storytelling way of describing the different type of people that you will encounter when it comes to data within an organisation. The funny story about this one, and Peter Rue always looks at me like, oh, do you have to tell people this, is the reason Tim wrote this chapter is about this time last year, when Peter was supposed to give me part of the book, and he'd done a lot of it, apart from about 2,000 words, and him and I had a lovely conversation, is how I remember it, And he'd come off the phone and went, Tim, can you help me and get 2,000 words or she might kill me. So Tim, bless him, came up about 2,000 and it just fitted, actually, we couldn't have planned it any better. It was just a nice little Easter egg in the middle of the book, tells a lovely story.
Yeah. I find that when I'm explaining data issues or data solutions across the business, quite often I use analogies, the bucket and water, in my case, bucket, pipes and water. I use a lot of analogies, like the wheels on the bus, you can't stop the bus and take the wheels off whilst you're delivering data strategy. The bus has to keep going and get to the destination. And so, three of Tim's stories in there are really good analogies, and I've used them on more than one occasion to explain to people the problem with their data and the problem with their way they're approaching data or the way they're asking the question. How can you possibly expect them to have that answer when I haven't done X, Y, and Z beforehand? And some of these stories are really good.
I guess this one, again, it's a pretty straightforward chapter. It talks a little bit about the technologies, but not a lot. The focus really is on that there are technical specialists. I'm sure some of you in the room are some of those technical specialists. We do not need to know the ins and outs of every piece of technology. What you do need to know as a chief data officer is an understanding of what it can do for you, what the art of the possible it is. You know, there is absolutely no point in going and talking to your CIO and going, I want the latest shiny stuff and it does all of this and I'm going to spend $10 billion, thank you very much, because it's never going to happen. You need to be able to be articulate when it comes to technology, but understand that there are people better off than you who can actually do a lot of the detail.
This is yours.
I know, I like this one, it's my favourite one. This almost comes with just a little bit of a story, so very, very quickly. The hoarding mentality came about because I have a little tradition. Because I travel a lot for work, on a Sunday morning, my currently 14-year-old son, who's 30 when this happened, he gets up on a Sunday morning and we get the pan of chocolate out and we get the fresh orange juice out and we just get lots of bad things for us on a Sunday morning. And we veg out across the settees, watch TV, and we pick the worst TV programmes that we can find. So I've made this poor boy watch Porn Stars, which is about porn shops, not porn. I have made him watch Say Yes to the Dress. I've made him watch all sorts of things this boy puts up with me. I have no idea why, but we just have a giggle on a Sunday morning. One of the programs that we watched was about hoarders. Those people that cram their houses so full of stuff that they can't actually use their stuff anymore. And it was, as we're sitting there, oh, bless. I suddenly realised that was us when it came to data. In a lot of organisations, we have crammed our organisations so full of data, just in case, because we might need it, that we can't actually use the house the way it was designed to be anymore. So this chapter talks about that, some of the principles that sit behind it, and ways that you can do something about it, because it's not an easy thing to do. If you try and tell somebody, right, well, we're going to delete all that data, ooh, they come up, sweats, hives. Why would you do that? Well, because basically, it's not about the volume, I don't believe. It's about the quality and the diversity of the data that you're using. Volume is somewhere else down the list, but we've got trapped into the mindset that storage is cheap, so it doesn't matter. Well, actually, the cost of your storage isn't the cost of storing your data. The cost is every single time you repeat something because you can't find it. The cost is every single time you make the wrong decision because you've got the wrong piece of data. It's not that we can't see the wood for the trees, we don't value the wood anymore. So the hoarding principle goes into some of that.
Yeah, and I think big data hasn't helped. The term big data, I think it's caused more issues perhaps than opportunities than it's offered. And I think the quicker we get and we start talking about data again and drop the B is really important. Going back to my IoT thing, we've got thousands of alarms sitting out across the network. When the alarms get triggered, it's like a tsunami of noise coming towards you. We don't need to collect or process all that noise. It's the exceptions we want. Those are the ones we really want. The rest of it says a pattern. I'm going to accept that. It's those interesting anomalies, the bits we want. So we don't want it all. What would we do with it?
Yeah.
it's the little pieces we want to know.
I had a perfect example, which is with our data science team, who are absolutely adamant that they needed all the data that they currently had access to. We had lots of conversations, lots of cajoling, are you absolutely sure, what are you using for, da da da. In the end, we did a very simple piece of analysis that demonstrated that they were using 5% of what they had access to. 5%. So do I use my resources to look after 100% of the data, or do I use my resources and really get into the data quality of that 5%? It's a little bit of a no-brainer when it comes to that kind of stuff.
We scanned our file shares and found out that something like 60% of the spreadsheets on our file shares haven't been opened in the last 2 years.
Just a quick question on data quality.
Yes.
How do you, as chief data officers, get that over to the CEO or the CFO to ensure that, I mean, data quality is a big thing. To try and fix it, you have to throw a bit of money at it.
Yeah.
How do you get that across them to say, you know, we have to spend this, and yes, there's an immediate thing, but there's this whole long-term view. What's the messaging?
I try and put it in a context that even if we spend the money to fix it and do a data cleaning exercise to improve the data quality, we've still got to embed it somehow into business as usual. Because otherwise, you know, data ages like fish. Yeah. It'll go off very rapidly. And so you have to build into business as usual some way of maintaining that data quality. So I try to explain them, you know, because you haven't done that BAU in the past, we're going to have to invest a bit. Now, I would pick on my critical data elements. It's a big bill. I'd pick on the 5% that's going to make a big difference to the CFO into his forecasting, or to the CEO in making good decisions, or into regulatory compliance to make good regulatory returns. I'd focus my energies there.
Quick wins.
Yep. Make sure that that money was spent with BAU built around it. Absolutely crucial. And I think it's a culture thing. It's letting people understand that at point of data entry, whether it's somebody in the field with an iPad, or somebody in the field with a piece of paper, or it's somebody on the phone in customer service, that the data they enter there can have quite significant results 18 months, a year down the line. And to try and fix that backwards is an expensive process, and you may never notice it actually, and it may be even more expensive out here overnight. So I think it's having a very honest conversation with the CFO and the CEO, and I think it all comes back to business case. One problem we have, I think, as CEOs is we're often seen as a cost centre. And getting that over and saying, like, okay, I'm going to sink money here, but I'm going to bring benefits there, there, and there.
Absolutely.
Do you have to do a sort of cost-benefit analysis sometimes?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I've written 3 business cases.
To convince the chief finance officer that he's not wasting his money.
Yeah, the CEO just gets it off a chat and a lift. Mm-hmm. He gets it straight away. It's a CFO that I have to produce reams and reams of paper for. And then track it. I mean, this morning, a lot of tracking phone call of benefits being delivered back into the business. But that's worth doing, because then they believe you next time.
Yeah, definitely. Cool. Data and information ethics. Anybody heard of, is it Information Analytica? Mm-hmm. Been in the news recently?
Cambridge Analytica,
yes, thank you very much. Yeah, it's quite topical at the moment.
Just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Absolutely. Do you know, the power of the data that we now hold about people is frightening. We have a tremendous responsibility, and as you say, just because we can doesn't necessarily mean that we should. You have to think about the consequences of your actions, and also, and I know this sounds really hard to do, but you also have to think about the unintended consequences of your actions. An example at Network Rail, if I put every train journey on the internet so that everybody could see it, and you knew what you were doing, just by looking at the gaps in the train services, you could tell me where the nuclear train was. Now, do you really want that kind of information being open source? Not really. So it wasn't what I would have done that would have caused that. It was a completely unintended byproduct of it. But those are the kind of things you have to watch out for. And one of the things is, guaranteed you'll get it wrong. Somewhere down the line, you will find that you have made a mistake when it comes to data, because it's just too easy, because those unintended consequences can hit you. It is the speed that you can react to that that is critically important. So you need to make sure that you build those mechanisms into whatever processes, whatever practices that you have in an organisation. Don't be frightened to go, no, quick, stop, do something else.
I think privacy impact assessments have helped enormously in getting people to stop and think. And they ask the right questions, if they've been, if the template's in the right format, would I want this done with my data? I also think that understanding data lineage is really important, where data has come from, where the consents around it, if we're talking about custom data or HR data, I think it's really important. Ethics around data. There's ethics around money. If we're going to make an analogy between CFO and CDO looking after a company asset, I think that there has to be ethics around data.
So, data governance. It is a large part of a chief data officer's role. I have a talk that I sometimes do about it's not really governance, it's assurance. And that's the state that you really want to get into as a chief data officer, where you are assuring. Actually, it's an enabling mechanism, if you really think about it. But people too often see the governance as a, oh God, you're going to stop me doing something. Probably, if I'm being honest. And then, but when you point out the consequences of what they're doing, did they really want to be doing it in the first place? By putting the right and appropriate governance in place for an organisation, actually making it simpler. You're making it streamlined. People understand what they can and can't do because it will be clear and because it's consistent. And if something changes, everything will change through it. So I actually see this as a very positive aspect, but that does take a bit of selling. And the chapter covers that in a little bit more depth.
Do you have a good definition of data governance, or where do you go to? Because there's a lot of, I find people refer to it and they mean different things. Where do you get your definition from?
I work with my, I have a peer who sits alongside me for CIA, and obviously he's responsible for information governance,
yeah,
which is around security and standards and transfer of data. The data governance we've defined in our organisation, in my realm, is around data quality, data standards, common data dictionaries, data lineage.
Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of framework of things which come together as governance.
Yeah.
What about the kind of organisational side of things?
We have an information governance council,
right,
which we both sit on. He chairs it, and I'm currently chairing the GDPR workstream. And we both sit on that. It's chaired, ultimately chaired by the CIRO.
Yeah.
And we both fit into that. So I'm raising issues around data quality, data standards, and he's raising issues around data security and information security.
And the business participates in that?
Yeah, we have, down in the business, we have data governance groups who are responsible for the ownership and stewardship of the data at their level, and we have information governance champions.
Sorry to go on, but is that something that you had to implement then? Your vision of what data governance was, that's part of your role then, to implement.
Certainly in my current role, it's something you have to implement from ground up.
It has to fit as part of the organisational
governance. Yeah, of course, yeah.
So it's not about creating something over here that doesn't work for the rest of the business.
No.
It's linking it in with the risk committees and other things that already exist.
Existing policies, like you said before.
Yeah. So in my previous role, there was a risk structure and an information governance structure, and I had to fit my data governance structure into that to complement it.
Yeah.
But it gave me an acceleration.
Like financial standing authority, for example, at one level, isn't it? Record management.
Yeah.
Data revolution. Now, there's lots of talk about the fourth industrial revolution being data and all the other good stuff around it. This chapter is actually not about that. It's about the data revolution that will take place in your organisations. Make no mistake, if you're going to work with data in a different way, it will change your organisation. So it's about the change aspects that you'll need to take care of. You know, human beings have this wonderful capacity to hang on to their comfort zone like their life depended on it. That hearts and minds thing that we talked about early on is something that you cannot take your eye off the ball. You have to focus all the way through everything you do. You have to be thinking about, how does that bring people on this journey with me? How does it improve? Where can they see the value? And what will elicit a change in behaviour with them?
Yeah, and it can fundamentally change business processes. Now, existing ways of doing things, they might throw 30 actuaries at a problem, if you have a nice algorithm that works out company covenants to support his pension, you might refocus that actuary's time into something else because you can crunch through the numbers so much faster with a nice bit of code. So it fundamentally changed business processes, and that has to be explained right the way through to the organisation what this means in its structure. Yes, this chapter was about advice to CEOs as to how to get a CDO if they wanted one, where to go and look for one, what to look for, the questions to ask, which perhaps search agencies or recruitment agencies to work with. And we have quite a few examples there from recruitment agencies and search agencies about how they go around finding the right person for the right job. So if you've got an organisation that wants to recruit a CDO and know where to go and find one, this is the chapter.
It really helps you.
One of the interesting clues in here, and it's certainly played out with me, and I know other people it's played out with, is often the bit of bait that will get a CEO interested, and it works with data scientists really well as well, is don't talk about the company, don't talk about the package, don't talk about the part of the world it's in, talk about the data. Mm-hmm. Talk about the data challenge and the data opportunity, the opportunity for that data to be transformational to that organisation, and their ears will prick up.
Yeah, we tend to
then you talk about package in which company.
Yeah, we tend to be problem solvers. Okay, so that is a flying summary, and I can't believe we've talked for an hour about the book. Of the book, we hope you found it interesting, and do you have any questions?
Well, thank you, Carla and Peter. So, questions from the floor.
What would you say was the key moments
Not being fired.
Yeah. So what's a good start?
Got your bonus.
Making a difference. So you, as Peter said, you have to track the benefits, you have to put the measurements in place. There are different elements of data around different data quality, variety, veracity, all sorts of good stuff. I find tending to build up measures in each one of those will give you something to be able to demonstrate it. There is